Joshua chapter number 8, or excuse me, Joshua chapter number 1, we'll look at verse 8 here in a moment. The Christian life is meant to be one that is lived joyously as God sufficiently and consistently meets the innermost needs of the heart. That's what we've been focusing on at this hour, is getting God to meet those innermost needs. It's what gives Christianity its power. And it's something that's being challenged in our day by the entertainment that exists in our world. Everybody's trying to get their needs met by everything else other than God. And they begin to realize as they live life that, you know what, nothing else is going to meet those inner needs that we all have. Many Christians have never learned how to get their innermost needs met by God. And my goal through this series is to try to help every individual here today, if you've been saved, if you're born again, how to get those needs met. Because if you and I do not get those needs met, we're going to live defeated. We're going to live frustrated. We're going to live anxiously. We're going to live overwhelmed. We're going to live with a lot of yuck inside consistently. And that's not the kind of life that God wants for every one of His individuals that are His. In other words, what's going to end up happening is that a person who's saved is going to live no differently than a lost person, or somebody who's never been saved. And actually, the results are far worse, as we've seen in the scripture passages already, for that person, because what's happening is they're getting a double whammy. They're sinning, but they're also quenching the Spirit of God, which is grieving Him. And it always leads to greater things, because also a person who knows better is accountable for more. And if they're accountable, then that means that there will be greater retribution on their part. It's just a very bad cycle in which to live. That's not the way God wants us to live. It doesn't have to be that way for somebody who is saved. Much of the problem, again, lies in the fact that the average born-again Christian doesn't have an intimate, passionate, personal relationship with God. And that is the crux of what Christianity, biblical Christianity, is supposed to be all about. And if you don't have that today, well, guess what? We're here to help each of us learn how to have one or have a better one so that we don't have to live life constantly dependent on every one of our circumstances turning out the way we want. And we don't have to constantly live hoping that somebody won't fail us. Because guess what? Every one of those things in life will fail us at some point. And sometimes they'll fail us bad. We don't want to be dependent upon our lives being dependent upon those things for our personal security and personal happiness. Again, if we try to, if without that relationship working, if you would, the Christian life will, the Christian, I should say, will seek to get his or her needs met or filled some other way. And that way, whatever it might be, will never suffice quenching the need. In fact, it will actually make the need get bigger. And we're trying to put that down. In our text here today, God tells Joshua that he had to be a man who stuck by the book. Because it was going to be critical for him as he was going to be leading this army into battle against foes much greater, much more powerful than him, that he was in constant communion and getting his innermost needs met by God. Of course, one of the greatest needs he would have had would be assurance. Because he was going up against fearful things. And he was going to have assurance that God was going to be with him to give him victory. Joshua 1, just one verse here today. Verse 8. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Today, as we continue our series, The Need Meter, we're going to look at some practical tips to help us receive communication from God as we read His Word, so that the Word of God will meet the innermost needs of our heart. Today, we're just going to continue on this subject of building a personal relationship with God. This is part of the Word. Father in heaven, I pray today that the Spirit of God will open our hearts to this understanding. I pray that you would speak in a very special way to help people see just how much you want to speak to them by word. Father, help me communicate the best that I can. May your Spirit make up what I lack in each heart of you today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, we've spent much time discussing how we all have these inner emotional needs within our hearts that must be met if we hope to live as Jesus promised. Jesus promised this: the thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and destroy. I am come that they might have life, that they might have it more abundantly. An abundant life, a life that is got joy, a life that's got some peace, a life that's got some value to it, a life that's got purpose. All those types of things. And over the years, as I've watched myself and I've looked at other people, I've come to see that sometimes I haven't lived the abundant life. I haven't experienced that. And sometimes God's people don't experience that. And we kind of think that, you know, the Christian life is just a bunch of, it gets to the point where we're just trying to keep up an image, or we're just trying to not do certain things and do other things. And that's what it's all about. No, it's not. That's not what it's all about. What it's all about is having a personal relationship with God. And as He leads us and directs us into things that please Him and don't please Him, then we do those things. That's out of a heart for Him, from the inside out. And so many Christians today are living life, even within their Christianity, so empty, because they do not have a personal relationship with God. Oh, again, they can keep up with the appearance. They can come to church. They can do certain things. But yet the relationship is lacking, thus the abundance of their life is lacking. And their Christianity is nothing more than a shell of what it could be. You know, God designed us to have these needs within so that He Himself could meet them. Again, the title of the series is The Need Meter. God is our need meter. He desires to meet our needs for us so we don't have to seek anything else in this world to fulfill them. Yet, as I've mentioned already, so many are doing that, even Christian people. They're looking to this world to find affection. In other words, to be loved unconditionally. Guess what? There is no person on planet Earth that can love you unconditionally. It doesn't matter if it's even your spouse, your mom, your dad, your sibling, your best friend. Guess what? They're going to fail you at some point. And no doubt, maybe across this room here, with the people here, though you've trusted somebody to love you and they failed you. Guess what? That's what people are prone to do. The Bible says in Psalm 39, verse 5, that man at his best state is altogether vanity. That's the best we've got going for us. Why? Because we're sinners. And we commit sin. And sometimes people hurt us. That's reality. But the thing is, it wouldn't hurt us so bad if we were getting our affection from a more, I guess you could say, a more consistent source. That's God. Then, of course, we need attention. In other words, we need to know that somebody cares we exist. We need to know that we're more than just a number, that our life has value. We need approval. We need to be encouraged. We need something to keep us going, even when everything tells us not to. We need universal acceptance. We need to be accepted for who we are or how we've been made. We need admiration. In other words, we need to feel that we're special. We need application. In other words, we need purpose in life. And of course, we need assurance. We need hope for the future. We need to have hope to have all this. That there's something better to come. That this isn't just all that there is. We need all of that stuff. And we can't get that stuff from the things of this world or the things are from other people. It is impossible. No person or thing will ever be able to supply that consistently and sufficiently for us. Only a relationship with God can do it. And as we've seen, in order to have a relationship with God, that relationship first must be restored. We as people are naturally born cut off from God due to the sin nature we all inherited from when Adam and Eve committed their first sin in the Garden of Eden. And as a result, there's been a separation between us and God. We have no relationship with Him. We as people have been cut off, and we need to be restored with Him. That's what happens when a person is born again. We saw this multiple times, this verse. Jesus speaking to that religious man He was trying to be religious and he was trying to please God, but he had no relationship with God. And Jesus told him why. You need to be, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. In order to have a relationship with God, you have to be born again. And we've seen the details of why we need to be born again, because there's a spiritual component within our hearts that needs to be rebirthed. That is needed to have fellowship with God. And it's something that needs to be restored. John 4:24, God is a spirit. They that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. God created us a three-part being. We saw that, again, remember the artwork. I think I showed it a few weeks ago. We were made a three-part being, just like God's a three-part being, if you would. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. God created each of us, each part of us, in correlation with each part of him. He made us a living soul. He made us a body, and he made us a spirit. And that during that fall, that spirit would die. And eventually, if things didn't happen, if things didn't stop, the body would die, and then the soul would die forever and eternity. But the day we're born again, that spirit is brought back to life. As through the spirit, we worship and have fellowship with God. Until that spirit has been rebirthed, there will be no fellowship with God at all. And a person has to have this time in their life when they've been born again. If you have not had that time, then you cannot get your needs met by God. It will not happen. And that might be some of the reasons why people struggle to get their needs met by God. They go to church, they do all everything what everyone says to do, but they've never been truly born again because of maybe a few things. Number one, maybe they just didn't understand the gospel message when they received it. They didn't understand the depth of it. They didn't understand what it means to repent of sin, come to realize that they've sinned against God, and that their sin is serious. And they needed to turn from that sin with all their heart to God. It's called repentance. And by faith, they needed to trust Jesus Christ to be their Savior, and not themselves anymore. Some people sometimes they make professions and they didn't understand all that. They just kind of said, prayed the little sinner's prayer, God, please save me, and didn't really realize how serious that really was. And they walk around with a false profession. Sometimes they did it for wrong motive. They thought that if they got saved or got born again, that God would just somehow magically take away all their problems. Guess what? That doesn't happen. It was a wrong motive. Or they made a profession because they wanted to be accepted by a group of people or a person. Or they wanted to make mommy or daddy happy. There's no relation, but they never truly understood and never really embraced the right means to get saved. If you're going to get saved or you're going to get born again, your motive has to be, I'm right with God. I want to get right with God. Number two, I'm willing to repent of my sin. I'm willing to turn from my ways to God's ways. I recognize that my sin is horrible. I don't want to go that direction anymore. And thirdly, you need to be willing to, by faith, trust Christ alone and not yourself to save you. Or to pay for your sin. And when a person has that heart attitude, when that is truly their heart's desire, the Bible just tells them very plainly, very simply, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved or born again. They just have to ask. But the problem for some people is that they don't want to embrace God's terms. And thus they'll never get saved. But if you're willing to embrace God's terms, you can be saved. And you and I need to have that happen in our lives. In order for that relationship to be there. Otherwise, there will be no relationship at all. And the day that somebody is born again, a person is put in a position now to have a relationship with God. Something each person must seek to cultivate. James 4:8, we saw last week, draw nigh to God, and you will draw nigh to Him. It's a command. We've got to make step forth the effort. And then God will respond. And last week I spent a lot of time on the special help that God has given each one of us if we've been saved. It's the Holy Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit of God is the agent at work in our lives who is helping us with a personal relationship with God. And He is our educator. He's our influencer. He's our empowerer. And he's the one that makes the Christian life work. And today we're going to see how the Holy Spirit works through the Word of God to build a relationship with Him. Because our time with God every day in His Word is critical in this thing of having a relationship with God. Because it's through God's Word God speaks to us most directly. And God will meet that here most. First off, let's talk about the preeminence. The preeminence of the, and I'm speaking of the preeminence of the Word of God itself. God's Word is of great value. It says that very plainly in Scripture. Job made this statement while he was in the midst of his greatest trials of life. Neither have I gone back from the commandment of his lips. I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. You look at that verse and you can tell very plainly the great value Job placed upon the Word of God. I think we all esteem food pretty highly. We can't live without it, right? Can't live without the breakfast you had this morning, the lunch you're going to have at noon, and the dinner you'll have tonight. Can't live without it. But Job says here, the words of his mouth are even of much greater necessity than that food that we so need. Obviously, by this statement, Job viewed God's word as the highest necessity in life. Like, I can't live without it. And you know what? Human beings can't live without it. Many are trying, but they're failing. Even born again Christians try than they before. When Jesus was confronted by the devil in Matthew chapter 4, the devil even approached him about meeting a hunger need that he had been fasting 40 days. Jesus had been there in that chapter. And the first thing that Satan tempts Christ with is, if you be the Son of God, command that these stones be turned into bread. Jesus responded back with this. But he, Christ, answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. As much and as much more as we need physical nourishment, we need the Word of God that much more. And Jesus was just simply quoting something that was found back in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy 8:3. That he might make thee know that man doth not live by bread only, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God doth man live. Even in our text, God told Joshua, keep my word at the forefront of your mind. The book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate thereon day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written there. Again, the great emphasis and the great preeminence of the Word of God is seen through these verses and many others we can pull out, I think, in Scripture. And before we get into the practical part of this message, we need to really stop and ask ourselves this question. How do I truly believe, or how do I truly feel about the Word of God today? How do I truly believe or view the Word of God as a necessity in my life? Do I see it as important as the food that I'm going to intake throughout the rest of this day and throughout this week? Or do I see it as something that's just I can take it or leave it? Do I see it as something that is not that important? Do I see it as something that is a great necessity of my life? How do we view the Word of God here today? How has our actions with God's Word this week proven that it is of great value to us? Think about that for just a little bit. Our opinion of God's Word will dictate what we do on a daily basis. It will dictate what we do on a daily basis. God's hope is that you and I hold His Word in great preeminence, in great reverence, because He does. So Psalm 138, verse 2, "For thou hast magnified thy word over all thy name." You know, God magnifies his word. How they love his name. Do we place that kind of emphasis on the word of God? Now, I know people today look at this book as a dusty old book. It doesn't work anymore. It's, you know, look, this book is timeless. This book has the answers to every question about life. It's when people do not hold God's word in high esteem, life gets messy. Is your life messy today? Everyone's got a little mess in their life, but you know, some people have got a lot of mess. How did that happen? Because the word of God is not elevated. Proverbs 13:3. "Whoso despiseth the word shall be destroyed, but he that feareth the commandment shall be rewarded." Very clear. Two opposite ends of the spectrum. "Whoso despiseth the word shall be destroyed." When we neglect the word of God, when it's not in a preeminent spot in our life, guess what? There will be no good that happens. And may God help us not to have to learn that lesson multiple times before we come to that conclusion. Oh yeah, you know what? I better start listening to what God has to say. Because life is too short. And sometimes those lessons are really hard and costly. We don't want to go that direction. Do you want to go that direction? I don't want to go that direction. Somebody will hear the word, oh yeah, that sounds good, but I got it figured out. We don't have it figured out, folks. We really don't. Not a single one of us has it figured out. Nobody here can do it on their own. I can't do it on my own. We need God. And God has given us his word. I believe the Bible has the answer to every one of our questions and problems we face in life. Can I ask us all this question to think about? Do we truly believe that is legitimate? Do we truly believe God's word has all the answers to the questions and problems we face in life? I believe it does. And if we do, we will not be content until we find the answers to our questions and problems from his word. Sometimes we have to spend some time seeking. The Bible tells us, they that seek the Lord understand all things. Are we willing to seek the Lord and find out the answers to those questions that are pondering our hearts today? If we do, we'll come to understand them. Sometimes we simply, let's just be honest here, sometimes we're just lazy about it. Right? Kind of get a little bit lazy, get slothful. Why? Because the word of God isn't as preeminent in our life, in our heart. We don't see it as more necessary than our food. We just kind of, oh yeah, let's put it aside. Yeah, that probably does. Or else, we'll pick it up and start, just half-heartedly read it. You're never going to have a relationship with God like that. You're never going to get your needs met with God like that. If that's the attitude we take towards. When we come to the Word of God, we have to come with an attitude of, I'm looking for something here. Because God will never spoon feed you and I. God wants us to take responsibility and look in the book. Ask questions. And don't settle until we get the right response. Proverbs 25:2 says, "It is the glory of God to conceal a thing, but the honor of kings is to search out that." Do we have that kind of mentality when it comes to the book of God? And as we grow in a relationship with God, we'll discover those answers. But it comes back to, okay, how serious do I think God's word is in my life? How serious do I think that I need to take God's word? If it's just something we maybe listen to a little bit on Sunday and that's about it, it will not take hold. It's something we've got to be in every single day. If you're saved, that shouldn't be a problem. How often do we engage in God's word? It tells us if we think it's preeminent or not. If you're going to have a relationship with God, we've got to be a people of the book. I just don't have time to do it. What can I encourage you to make time? Because we make time for everything that's important to us. Again, it comes back to our attitude. How important is this book? Secondly, let's talk about the preparation. Okay, I know it's preeminent and all that. But I've read, I've never gotten anything out of it. And maybe today you have read your Bible, got to the end of a chapter, and not even known what you've read. Have you ever done that? A lot of people kind of chuckle. Okay, I'm guilty too. I've done that too. Like, I read it, I'm like, no. Or you got done reading, and what you read made no meaningful impact on your heart. I think that happens more often than we would want to admit. But one of the problems is the lack of personal preparation. You gotta remember who you're coming for. It's the Almighty God. You can't treat him, you know, just haphazardly and casually. You gotta come before him with a prepared heart. You know, Ezra, the Old Testament scribe, had that attitude. It says in Ezra 7:10, "For Ezra had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord and to do it, and to teach him Israel's statutes and judgments." He had prepared his heart. Well, how do you prepare your heart? I'll just give you a couple of things that I think will help. I'm not saying it's all inclusive, but I think these alone will make a big difference. Number one, ask God to reveal any sin between you and him. Before you start into the book, you and I need to sit there and God, is there anything that is between me and you this morning? Whatever you do. Are you going to confess sin in my life? The Bible says if you come to God, you have to have clean hands and clean heart. Clean heart means free of sin. Clean hands means that things are, the things we've done have been confessed or taken care of. You can't come to God with a dirty heart. And we need to ask God to reveal any areas that we may need to confess to him and repent of it. After salvation, sin can still hinder the fellowship between us and God. Isaiah 59:2, we've seen before. Before salvation, it puts the wall up, but guess what? After salvation, though we're forgiven, our sin can still, and will never take away our salvation, but our sin can still hinder our relationship with God. Because iniquities separate us between you and your God, your sins have hid his face from you that he will not appear. Sin will always play a role. There's several places in Scripture where it talks about how God will not answer the prayers of people who have open sin in their life. And just will, it always hampers the fellowship. And what we need to do before we enter God's Word is ask God to show us any areas that we might not be right. Psalm 139, verses 23 and 24. "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting." Sin will always hurt your fellowship with God, and God's ability to communicate with you will be hampered if there's open sin in our lives. And what we need to do is before God is say, "God, please, if there's anything between us, me and you, please reveal it to my heart." Maybe it was a thought that some thinking you were doing yesterday, or maybe it was an action of some things you said, or whatever it might be. We need to make sure that everything's clean before us. We need to be ruthless with our sin. Too often we're a little apathetic with it. We need to be ruthless with it. So, you know, and dispel it. If we don't know, we need to ask God, is there anything there? And if he brings something to your mind, guess what? It's time to confess and repent. And the Bible says in 1 John 1:9 that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. And it cleanses us from all unrighteousness. I remember here recently for me, I had a day where I had a real bad attitude. I had a bad attitude. I remember the next day trying to come before God. And I can I knew I had that, and I confessed it. And I felt bad about it. I felt like, you know what, that was just not right. You know, it's amazing how much love and grace God will show you if you and I will just acknowledge the sin. That's all God wants out of us more than anything, doesn't he? Acknowledge that we did wrong. God isn't interested in us covering it up, but too often we're trying to cover it up just like Adam and Eve did with their sin. We need to uncover that and deal with it. We can't approach God with dirty hearts and dirty hands with sin. Sometimes we aren't getting anything out of our time in God's Word simply because we have sinned between us and God and has not been dealt with. And when we ask God, the Holy Spirit of God will bring things to mind, and that's when we confess and forsake. Number two, there must be a willingness of submission. To be submissive to God. As we approach the Word of God, we must consciously submit ourselves to the Holy Spirit. Last week we talked about being filled with the Spirit. It means that we are controlled by Him. And to be controlled by Him means that we need to be submissive to His leadership in the promptings that He gives us. If we're going to go to the Word of God and God tells us to do something, we've got the attitude, I'm not going to do it no matter what God says. But guess what? You know what? He's not going to talk to you. He's not going to speak to you. You are not going to get your needs met. Or the lack of submission. I had a whole message on that here a few weeks ago. That if we're going to get anything out of God, we're going to have to be submitted to His Word and the things that He tells us to do. And His leadership and to the filling of His Spirit. What we need to ask God to do is this. We just need to ask the Holy Spirit of God to control us and teach us specifically what we need to know from God that day and empower us to obey it. Empower us to understand it and spread it. Just the attitude, God, you can have your way with me. God, you can teach me what I need to know. God, I want to learn. I want to hear from you so that I can apply it into my life. That's an attitude of submission. If we've got an attitude of, I'm not going to change. I don't think I can change. I don't want to change. I don't want to do what you're leading me to do. Guess what? God ain't going to speak to you. He's not. Why? Because we are trying to be God in that situation. And there's only one God. And sometimes the greatest struggles people have are just giving up that Godship in their own life. I want to be God. I want to tell God about what I expect, what I want, all this kind of stuff. And I was like, we got to remember who He is. One of the greatest victories every person will live will get is getting to the point where they can just submit to the Holy Spirit and God's leadership and have that mentality when they approach God and His Word. John 14:26 says, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, He shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you." God's got some things to say to us. The Holy Spirit will do that. We've got to be submissive to what He's saying to us. If we come to God's Word with a haphazard, I'm just going to try to get this off my plate, off my back, check it off my list type attitude too, again, don't be surprised if you don't get much out of it. Our attitude to coming to this book plays a big role in what we get out of it. By the way, that's the same thing when you come to church. We come to church, well, I'm just going to get the church thing off the checklist because going to church is a good thing to do, and blah, blah, blah. But you're not going to get a thing out of it. If we come with the attitude of church like that, we're not going to get a thing out of it. But we come like with the mentality, God, you've got something to say to me, and I want to hear it. Oh, you'll hear it. Loud and clear. That's why God wants us to be loud and clear. Again, don't be surprised if you don't get much out of it. There isn't that attitude of submission. Number three, there must be focus. You know, whenever I've told or tried to help people develop a walk with God, something I've always tried to do is encourage you to do it in the morning. Before the day gets spinning and everything's going on in your mind and your heart, and it's a lot easier, I think, to start in the morning, if at all possible. Sometimes it's not, I understand, but if you can get it done first thing in the morning, that's great. If it appears that the day invade your heart, and then your focus gets skewed because you're thinking about multiple different things. In order to get things out of the Word of God, there must be a level of mental focus, a concentration. You know, if that's something you struggle with, this is something you couldn't even do. Keep a pad of note paper next to you, and you have something that comes, I'm going to get this done. Write it down. Then you know what's to be done, and you can go to the back of it later. That might be something you might need to do to help you focus. Again, maybe it'd be best not to open Facebook right away, or the email, or whatnot, if it's a struggle for you. Maybe it's best not to turn on Good Morning America, or whatever you might watch in the morning. That's the first thing that you hear and see. Maybe it'd be the best thing, just keep going off. I don't know, whatever it takes, if you struggle with focusing, that might be some of those things that are adding towards that. Because if you're going to get something out of the Word of God, you have to be focused on it. You have to focus and come with a submissive spirit and ask God if there's any sin that needs to be revealed, that needs to be dealt with. Again, the more we can silence the mind, the better off we're going to be, and the easier it's going to be to hear from God. Thirdly, let's talk about the protocol. The protocol. So once we've prepared our heart, how can I read so that I can get something from God that meets my needs? And today I'm just going to give you some tips. I've actually got a booklet that we're going to have on order here this week that talks about how to have a daily time with God. And it's actually excellent. I've taken a lot of the things out of this. Out of that book for this message. Again, if you've got something that you're doing that's working and God is meeting your need, stay with it. Great. But if God is not meeting your need and you don't have much of a relationship with God, then it's time maybe to change and try something else. Because if we don't have a walk with God, you will not survive a Christian life. I can't say that more often. And it's not our interest to see people fall out of the Christian. It's not our interest to see people shipwreck. It's not in our interest to see people's lives messed up and their marriages falling apart, their kids going astray, or anything like that. Look, if you don't have a walk with God, you will not survive this Christian race. You'll go back to the world. You'll go back to defeat. And you will never get your needs met. At least that's the way I see it from the Word of God. And I've seen that practical life. I've lived long enough to see that. So if you got what's going on, if what you're doing is working for you, stay with it. But maybe today it isn't working for you. Maybe you don't have much of a walk with God. Maybe take some of these tips and you can incorporate them into your life. And I hope that they're helpful. I think number one, if you're going to go to the Word of God, this is something I've done for years. In fact, I've even changed it up here just recently. But I have a notebook. Down, just flip on the Word of God. All right, well, I'll just read a little bit. I've done that before, but that's when I read and I don't get as much out of it. I just noticed that for me. It's probably pretty similar for a lot of people. I would go with a notebook. What is that saying to God? I'm ready to learn. You know, some of you that have been in college or some of you that have been in high school, you know, if you came to the class, just sitting there, all right, teach me. And you didn't have a notebook. The teacher would know that you weren't real serious about learning, right? Well, we come with a notebook. Not that it's something that we impress God with, but I'm saying that it's something that you can use to record what God is speaking to you through God. And I think that's important. That you, if God spoke to you about something, that you write it down. Because it helps us focus on looking for something from God as we read. I'll guarantee it, it will help you. If you just kind of read it through, you're going to just run through the verses, you're going to run through it. But if you're going there, okay, I'm looking to learn, and I'm watching, and I'm looking for something to write down. It brings a lot more mental focus, doesn't it? I mean, it'll change. Now, again, I mentioned that booklet, something that, this booklet encouraged me to do, to help keep yourself a little, accountable. Right at the top of it, take a sheet of paper, that notebook, right on the top of the date and the chapters that you read. Because if you go multiple days, you'll know that you're not as faithful as you should be. But it helps bring some accountability. And then on that sheet of paper, write a few questions. Write some questions that, can be answered. Number one, God, what are you speaking to me today about? What is it that you want to speak to me today about? And as you read, seek God's answer to that. Number two, God, what kind of commandment do you want me to follow today? Number three, God, what promise do you have for me today? Number four, God, how do you want me to apply what I've learned today from my book? Number six, Lord, what other additional thoughts do you have for me today? See, if we approach the Word of God with questions, and we're consciously looking for answers, guess what? God starts, the Holy Spirit will illuminate things that God wants you to. And when God starts speaking to you, that's kind of special. It starts meeting those inner needs. Because you're having communication with God. And God wants to speak to you about certain things. God wants to change certain things in your life. God wants to encourage you in certain ways. God wants to guide you, but He can't do it unless you're in His book. And these are things that you can go over. You can do as you read, is ask questions and let God answer them. And of course, you can focus on reading an amount of scripture that's comfortable for you to at least to get those questions answered. Maybe 2 to 4 chapters, whatever works. You might need to read more, whatever the case might be, but it's whatever is needed for us to get answers to our questions from God. You can mark and highlight things in your Bible that the Holy Ghost points out to you. You know, throughout my Bible, I've highlighted different things. I've written some different things down that spoke to my heart. Their promises, their commands, their principles, things like that, that I can go back to. And by the way, when you come back to them at some point in your reading, you can read over what you read a moment ago, and you can, again, rehash what you gained. Number two, stop and meditate. You know, God's going to give you a text. He's going to give you a verse. The Bible tells us that we are to be meditators of His word, not just readers. Psalm 1:2 says, "But His delight is in the law of the Lord, this is the blessed man, and in His law doth he meditate day and night." In our chapter here, in our text, verse 8, Joshua was told to meditate there day and night on the book of the law, in the words of God. Now, to meditate means that we roll things over in our minds. And we're good at that. We're good at meditating over worrying about things, over things that we're mad about. Oh, we meditate all the time on all these negative things, but God wants us to meditate on all these good things that He's trying to point out to us. And as you're reading, the Holy Spirit of God will illuminate a passage, and He'll illuminate a verse or a section of a verse, and that is directly to you. And that is meant for you to meditate on and chew on for a little while in your mind. Because there is a principle, there is a command, there is something that God is trying to communicate to you as you read His Word that is meant for you. And when He does that, it does something to your inner being. It meets those needs. As you read, and that happens, stop, focus, and meditate on it. Read it several times over. Look up words that you don't know. Because there's something God wants us to know that will meet that need. And write it down as it pertains to your questions. And consider number three, how repetition is key. You know, we learn best through repetition. Isaiah 28:10 says, "For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little and there a little." Our best teacher is repetition. And what you can do is start, if you're going to read the Word of God, you're going to start digging into it, you know, start in the New Testament books. Start with Psalms, start with Proverbs. Because those have critical components of Christian living. As you get through those, learn the background of the book. It helps in an interpretation, because so much of Scripture is taken out of context sometimes because people don't understand who the book is written to, and it leads to miscued doctrines and things like that. Learn the background of the book. Work through the book at least twice or more. Get well acquainted with it. The continual intake with the engraft will engraft the Word into our hearts and help us come to understand it. Of course, once you work through those books, start incorporating the Old Testament books. Now, I mentioned that booklet I had a moment ago. There was a suggested reading order in there. I won't go over that for the sake of time. But as we grow in our understanding of God's Word, His Word will meet the needs and bring the change that we need in our lives. Because He'll speak to you. God's Word, as we meditate upon it, will burn into our heart what God wants us to do and will empower us. And it'll actually be a joy to do instead of grievance. It'll actually make a difference. Do you desire to build a personal relationship with God? If you do, then it means that you're going to have to evolve into His Word. You're going to have to look into His Word to hear from Him. Because He's got a lot to say to each of us. But it's going to take some heart preparation. I hope that some of the protocol again will help you if you're struggling to get something out of God's Word as you read it. The whole goal is to help you focus and to listen with a prepared heart to receive what God has to say to you, so that relationship can build and that He can be the intermediate part. If it isn't working today, then maybe today it's time to start changing that. And I hope that today some of these things can help. Because the last thing you want to do is live a defeated Christian life that is of no different than the lost life that you did to life. May God help us today build that relationship. Let's stand up. With every head bowed this morning, every eye closed. Maybe today, your relationship with God is on the rocks. Maybe you don't have one. Maybe today some of the things that we saw will be a help to you. I hope so. Because without a personal relationship with God, without God meeting your needs, we will go back to the world. We'll go back to those things and we will be susceptible to the satanic influence into our life, which is nothing meant to hurt. It will be nothing more than something meant to destroy you. As the pianist plays here today, if God has spoken,